I am Duane Brown. Tonight on KPBS Evening Edition, President Obama comments on an experimental Ebola drug that was developed with the help of San Diego researchers. California leads the nation in solar installations for homes and businesses.
Plus, the Ebola death toll rises to above 930 deaths. How does the virus spread? How does it compare to other viruses? And what a San Diego researcher is doing to find a treatment. I'm Peggy Pico with an update. And then, the new and unique San Diego program that helps people with high blood pressure reduce the risk of heart attacks and strokes from home. How you can participate.
And part one tonight of a series on a San Diego brain surgeon who uses 3D imaging tools in the operating room. KPBS Evening Edition starts right now. Hi, good evening. Thanks for joining us. The death toll continues to rise from the West Africa outbreak of Ebola. A San Diego company has developed an experimental serum being used on two Americans. Here's what President Obama said today about only using the drugs on Americans.
We're focusing on the public health approach right now because we know how to do that. But I will continue to seek information about what we're learning with respect to these drugs going forward.
Peggy Pico is talking with one of the San Diego researchers involved in developing that experimental treatment.
Two American aid workers infected with Ebola received ZMapp, an experimental treatment serum made by MAP Biopharmaceutical in Sorrento Valley. How do you get Ebola? How does it spread? What's the risk here in San Diego? And what does the latest research tell us about finding a cure? Here with those answers and more is my guest, Erica Ullman-Sapphire, co-director of the Global Virus Network Center of Excellence at Scripps Research Institute. Welcome.
Thank you for having me.
Now, Erica, what is Ebola briefly, and how do you get infected?
Well, Ebola is a very bad virus, and you get infected by contact with infected body fluids, so blood or vomit or diarrhea, usually taking care of an infected patient.
It's not transmitted, I understand, through sneezing or coughing. How is it transmitted, and describe the symptoms for us and how it's diagnosed?
Well, it's transmitted by body fluids. So if you're taking care of a patient, you're exposed to their vomit or their blood or those kinds of things, or if the needle was used in them and then in you, that would get you infected. Now, the symptoms begin with fever and headache, but progress to hemorrhage and shock and organ failure and necrosis of the tissues and the cells.
And how do you diagnose that?
It can be diagnosed a number of different ways. You can use PCR to look for viral nucleic acids in the cells. That's very rapid. You can also detect patient antibodies. That's the patient's response to the virus. That comes later. And you can look for particles of the virus themselves.
Through blood tests?
Yes.
I see. Compared to global death rates for other viral infections, and we're talking around the world here, the actual number of deaths from Ebola is relatively low, with 932 Ebola deaths so far this year, compared to about 122,000 annual flu deaths and about 1.6 million AIDS-related deaths each year. But 90% of those infected with Ebola do die. Do we know why there's such a high mortality rate with this particular virus?
There are a number of reasons for that. The virus is very tricky. So first, it replicates rapidly. At time of death, a patient could have a billion copies of the virus in a cubic centimeter of their sera. So that's a lot of virus. Second, the virus expresses molecules that actively suppress your immune system, so they prevent you from mounting the immune response you would need to fight it. And third, the virus rearranges and changes itself as it goes into the cell. So it's a moving target.
I know you direct the global consortium that's working on finding an Ebola treatment as well as treatments for other viruses. What can you tell us about the ZMapp, the experimental serum that's been given to some victims under a compassionate use? Really, the reason it's
right.
Compassionate. It hasn't been tested in humans before.
Of course not. No, it's still a research product. So this is three purified antibodies put together. So an antibody is a molecule your immune system would make to fight an infection. It's what you get after a vaccine, your own body would make it. Here we're delivering the antibodies immediately. And so the way they work, so this is a model of the surface protein of the Ebola virus. This is the kind of work my lab does. You see blue and white. Blue is what would attach to the new human cell to drive it in. Now the white, wrapped around the blue like a thread around a spool, is a piece of protein machinery that's spring-loaded, like a spear fishing rod. And in infection, it'll uncoil and drive the virus into the human cell. Now, this is the same molecule with an antibody bound to it. So what the antibody has done is it's anchored itself here, locking the pieces of the machinery together. It's neutralized the virus by preventing it from infecting other cells. Other antibodies in the ZMAP cocktail alert the immune system to the presence of that infection, so your immune system can clear the virus and clear infected cells.
It's still experimental, though, so what do we know about how effective it's been so far?
Well, it's early days. This is a research product. So MapBio and the Public Health Agency of Canada and USAMRIID had seen that in test tubes it could neutralize the virus. They saw that it could protect mice. They saw that it could protect non-human primates, and the earlier the better. 24 hours or even 3 days after exposure to the virus, the antibodies could save all of the primates. Later, it gets more difficult to save them. So there's definitely a treatment window.
Well, I understand there's 5 species of the Ebola virus. How does that impact research and development of new drugs or treatments for it?
Well, that's the challenge. There are these 5 species, and they're co-circulating. They're all different. You have to have antibodies that against each one of them. And that's one of the reasons we have this global consortium, where 25 laboratories across 7 countries are all putting their resources into one single study to develop treatments like ZMAP for all the other viruses like it that circulate in Africa and in Asia.
Well, I know the U.S. military and federal government are involved in Ebola research. Let me ask you this. How is the government's involvement actually impacting, let's say, your Ebola research or research around the world on this?
We couldn't do it without them. All of this is paid for by federal funding. So the NIAID pays all of the salaries and all the consumables and all the animals. It's critical. We can't do anything without those federal research dollars.
Okay. And I guess you'll keep us posted on what's going on from here. There's a lot more on our website, kpbs.org. Erica Ullman-Sapphire, thanks so much.
Thank you for having me.
Well, if you've been on the web today, you probably heard about a Russian hacking gang that's collected billions of computer passwords. The security breach affects information from over 400,000 websites last year. A security breach at Target stores affected about 100 million users. This breach affects more than 10 times as many users.
The way they were gathering credentials, they were kind of bottom feeding. They were buying the databases that were not they were on the black market, but they were not really relevant at the time. They were kind of being discarded by the owners. So they got a whole bunch of those records for free or really close to being free. And then the rest of them, they were just using them for spam, so it was not a big deal. From about April going on, they start exploiting sites in mass quantities. We can't tell exactly when it began or if there was some activity before April.
To keep your information safe, update your passwords and don't use the same one twice. Use antivirus software and sign up for the 2-step verification process offered by most big online companies. Padres have confirmed the hiring of A.J. Preller as general manager. Preller was the assistant manager for the Texas Rangers and succeeds Josh Burns, who was fired in June. Preller is the 10th general manager in Padres history. North County held its first craft brew symposium earlier this afternoon in Vista. Allison St. John joins me from the KPBS newsroom to talk about this thriving industry. So, Allison, San Diego is developing a national reputation for its craft brewing. Where are the hop spots in the North County?
Well, Duane, craft beer is making quite a splash these days. The number of breweries and brew pubs is multiplying all along the 78 corridor between Oceanside and Escondido. There are now 39 breweries and tap rooms up there, which has prompted the San Diego North Economic Development Council to dub Highway 78 the Hops Highway. They've produced a handy little map here showing craft beer lovers exactly where to find all those pubs. The biggest concentration is in Vista, which has become the brew capital of North County. But there are brew pubs in San Marcos, in Oceanside, Carlsbad, and in Escondido.
And what seems to be leading to this craft beer love?
Well, Eric Bruvald says the biggest beer drinkers are in their late 20s, 30s, and early 40s. And that generation, he says, has discovered a palate for hoppier beers. He points out that once developed, that taste of craft beer is likely to last a lifetime. So it's a trend that should carry the industry for years to come. It's becoming a refreshingly strong element of North County's economy, too. In fact, one of their industry hubs, generating more than $270 million a year and creating 1,700 jobs just in North County.
Wow. Any difference, Allison, between the craft beer industry in the city of San Diego, say, versus the North County?
Well, craft beer lovers may have to use their discriminating palates to decide that. But one distinction is that there are more large craft breweries like Stone Brewing in North County, and they export more than the smaller brew pubs in San Diego.
Our North County Bureau Chief, Allison St. John. California Senate killed a bill that called for a ban on fracking in the state, but environmentalists are still calling on the governor and lawmakers to stop the practice. Fracking involves injecting water, sand, and chemicals into rock formations to extract oil. Dan Jacobson with the environmental advocacy group Environment California says fracking is not a good use of the state's water.
Well, the ban bill is dead. And so that's the first thing. And so now we're counting on the governor to look at the state of California and see that we're in a drought. And since we're in a drought, it doesn't make sense to open up a new industry that's going to use so much water. And so we're just saying, let's put a stop on fracking in the state of California, at least until we're out of the drought.
Supporters of fracking say it creates jobs, increases state revenue, and decreases the state's dependency on imported oil. A new report shows California is leading the nation among homes and businesses running on solar power. Last year, solar capacity in the state grew 48% and nearly tripled nationwide. As the solar industry grows, the cost of installation continues to fall, down 60% between 2011 and 2013. The report from Environment California Research says for homeowners, a lot of it has to do with incentive loan programs like PACE, reducing the cost of installation and equipment.
San Diego ranks in the top five cities in the state. We have, and I think this is because, you know, municipalities have taken the lead and installed solar in on their city buildings.
Jobs in the solar industry are also growing rapidly. Last year, more than 140,000 jobs were created in the U.S., including 47,000 right here in California. Shipping companies, air regulators, and environmental groups are beginning an experiment to reduce air pollution and the number of whales being hit by cargo ships. The idea is pretty simple. Ships would be paid $2,500 to slow down as they make their way along the California coast. Dozens of whales have been killed by ships. To make the money, they would have to travel at 12 knots or slower for about 130 miles from Santa Barbara to Long Beach. Removing a brain tumor is an extremely delicate operation. One wrong move and a patient can be left paralyzed or worse. To ensure accuracy, surgeons at UC San Diego are using a unique combination of 3D imaging tools to look at the brain's inner structure. In the first of a two-part series, KPBS health reporter Kenny Goldberg examines the anatomy of a brain surgery.
Michelle Carpinelli looks like she has it all. She has a beautiful home, a loving family. But ever since the 52-year-old Carpinelli was diagnosed with breast cancer in 2010, she's been put through the ringer. She's had a mastectomy, a hysterectomy, radiation, and numerous cycles of chemotherapy. Then, a little over a year ago, Carpinelli experienced a different kind of pain.
I had pressure on my forehead and headaches, and then just before my operation, I had blurred vision in my right eye.
Doctors discovered Carpinelli had a brain tumor. She decided to go to the Cleveland Clinic in Ohio to get it taken care of. Carpinelli thought the procedure went well.
When I woke up, there was hardly any pain. My headaches subsided. My blurred vision was gone.
But recent scans reveal Carpinelli now has another larger brain tumor. It's so close to the original one that doctors aren't sure whether it's scar tissue or a separate growth. So it's back to the operating room for Carpinelli. She says even though she's had brain surgery before,
you still feel a little, you know, timid. You know, it's your brain. You know, they're going to open you up and you never know what's going to happen. So, but I have faith in Dr. Chin.
Dr. Clark Chen is Carpinelli's neurosurgeon. In his office at UCSD Moores Cancer Center, Dr. Chen talks about the combination of groundbreaking imaging tools he uses to plan his surgery. He starts with an MRI of Carpinelli's brain.
What you could see with a conventional MRI is that there's a region of abnormality that seems brighter than the rest. And this, to us, is very worrisome for a metastasis or a form of breast cancer that went to the brain.
The tumor is very deep, near the center of the brain. Chen explains the MRI displays only the barest outlines of the tumor and the brain itself. If he were to rely on this image alone to guide him, it would be like operating in the dark. But thanks to a 3D imaging technique called tractography, Chen can superimpose the neural connections in the brain that surround the tumor.
And so by looking at this and studying this carefully, a neurosurgeon could get a sense of where the tumors are, where the tumor is located, where the key tracts are located, so that in our mind we could define a trajectory that gets to the tumor without severing any of these tracts.
Using these images, Chen is able to chart the safest path to reach the target.
You see, there is a blue line, and that defines how I'm going to get to the tumor. And as you rotate this around, you will see that that trajectory in no way intersects any of these critical tracts in the brain.
Chen will perform the surgery inside an MRI suite so he can get real-time images of Carpinelli's brain. But because of the intense magnetic field in the MRI machine, all of the surgical instruments must be made of plastic. After a small hole is drilled in Carpinelli's skull, Chen will place a special frame around the entry point. Next, he'll attach what's called a controller to the frame.
Now, you know that with an MRI, the space is very small, so this is actually far away from the surgeon. So in order to access the controls, we have these controllers that basically serve as extenders. And these are inserted into these grooves.
When everything is in place and the images confirm that Chen has found the right pathway to the tumor, he'll use a flexible laser probe to destroy it. Chen is the only neurosurgeon in the world who uses this combination of next-generation surgical tools along with these advanced imaging techniques as his standard of care. Chen says when he first saw the neural structure of the brain displayed on his computer, he knew it would be a game-changer for neurosurgeons.
We spend our lives dedicated to neuroanatomy. We do dissections, we visualize, we use computer simulations in order to appreciate and understand where these tracks are. And to see that in real life is the face of God.
In our next segment, we'll take you inside the operating room as Dr. Chen goes to work on Carpinelli's brain tumor. Kenny Goldberg, KPBS News.
KPBS video journalist Katie Shulove helped produce that piece. Part two airs tomorrow night right here on Evening Edition. Well, disappointment this afternoon for the Encinitas Little League All-Stars. They lost 8-4 to a team from Las Vegas, but it's not over yet. The All-Stars are already qualified for the semifinals on Friday in San Bernardino. San Diego Chargers are expecting long lines for tomorrow's preseason opener at Qualcomm Stadium. The team is urging folks to arrive at least a couple of hours early for the game against the Dallas Cowboys. Of course, extra Green Line trolleys will be up and running to and from the stadium as well as afterwards. Now the game starts at 7 o'clock tomorrow night. A new county program received a nearly $6 million grant to help people reduce their risk of heart attacks as well as strokes. Peggy Pico has more on the program.
The San Diego A Heart Attack and Stroke-Free Zone program is a collaboration of local healthcare organizations. Their hands-on approach involves helping patients monitor and control their blood pressure from home. Dr. Anthony DeMaria, the program's principal investigator at UC San Diego Health System, and Dr. Nick Efantides, chief medical officer for County Health and Human Services. Welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Now, Dr. DeMaria, heart disease is still a number one cause of death in the U.S. among men and women, I understand. What are the signs of heart disease, and why are so many people still unaware they have a problem until it's too late?
Well, the signs of heart disease are actually fairly straightforward: chest pain or shortness of breath. But heart disease can be present for quite a long period of time before symptoms show themselves. And what we're focusing on is even earlier in the process, and that's on risk factors, so that risk factors that are present can lead to the appearance of disease, which subsequently can become symptomatic. We want to get it at the risk factor stage so we can eliminate those heart attacks and strokes.
And one of the risk factors is, of course, high blood pressure. How does it contribute to heart disease?
Well, high blood pressure is one of the major risk factors. We know it increases the risk of heart disease dramatically. It also is a major risk factor for stroke, and it's a stress on the vascular system overall, and in stressing the vascular system, it facilitates the appearance of these atheromatous plaques that are the real cause of the heart attack and the stroke.
Kind of the hardening of the arteries and the plaque in the arteries?
Yeah, we call it hardening of the arteries, and it often is because those plaques get calcified, but they start with lipids, cholesterol in particular, that's in the plaque, and it's like kinking a garden hose. You just can't get enough blood through that kinked artery, and ultimately, if a blood clot forms, you can't get any blood through, and that's the heart attack or stroke.
And Dr. Nick, this three-year project that we're talking about aims to reduce heart attacks and strokes throughout the county. How's it going to work?
Well, we are going to start off with targeting individuals who are high risk, individuals, 4,000 folks who we know are very likely, if they go untreated, to end up having heart attacks. But what's exciting about it, and why the county is so supportive as part of Live Well San Diego, is that it really is a collaborative effort involving every major medical group in the region and a lot of smaller medical groups and community clinics working together for a common cause. We're going to be promoting compliance with medication. We're also going to be providing patients extra encouragement to take the medicines that they're supposed to take, and also have some exciting features like wireless blood pressure monitoring from home that will hopefully encourage folks to be compliant, consistent with taking their therapy.
And that help you're talking about, health coaches are going to actually come to the home. Now, Dr. DeMario, why do patients need help taking their blood pressure medication? Why is there non-compliance?
Well, there's non-compliance for all medications. Adherence is a major problem within medicine, but it's particularly important when you're treating a condition that is not associated with symptoms. People who have high blood pressure don't have pain. People who have high cholesterol don't have aches or immobility. And so they're taking a medication now, not to ease a symptom, but to prevent something in the future. And it's just so easy to say, oh, I just won't bother with it right now.
And Dr. Nick, when does this program start, and who's eligible?
Well, we have started the planning already. We had a big meeting this week. The program begins in earnest in September, and we're going to be recruiting patients towards the end of this year into the early part of next year. This program that we're talking about specifically today was funded by the federal government, so there's a focus on high-risk individuals who have Medicare or Medi-Cal. But our hope, as we do good work with these folks, would be to take it broader to the entire population of the region.
Well, you mentioned about 4,000 participants in there. How can people participate?
The decision for participation is really going to come through the medical groups that they're a part of. And so we have many of the groups in our region who are actively involved. It's something that we would encourage patients to ask their physician about.
Well, I know the long-term goal of this program, as you said, spread it across the entire county. But in the title, it says San Diego Heart Attack and Stroke-Free Zone. Let me start with you, Dr. DeMaria. How realistic do you think that goal is?
Well, I think that it's not realistic in the precise sense of eliminating all heart attacks and strokes. However, by modeling studies, we know we can reduce heart attacks and strokes by probably about two-thirds and perhaps more. So we can make an enormous difference. More importantly, By making San Diego heart attack and stroke-free zone, it makes everybody a participant in the project, not just for us. And we appeal to them to take care of themselves, not for themselves, but for some loved ones. And that's where the be there comes from.
And Dr. Nick, do you think it's possible?
Absolutely, I think it's possible. Too much of what we currently do in America, it's sick care. This is really about health care, being proactive and preventing bad things from happening in the first place.
All right. Well, Dr. Nick Efantidis and Dr. DeMaria, thank you so much.
We appreciate the
opportunity.
Thank
you.
I'm Judy Woodruff. On the next NewsHour, we look at the legacy of the war to end all wars. 100 years since the guns of August roared and World War I began. That's Wednesday on the PBS NewsHour.
Well, that monsoonal moisture from Baja is gone. You may have noticed temperatures slightly cooler today and plenty of sunshine around the county. In fact, we're looking at a mix of sun and clouds along the coast over the next few days. Morning clouds and clearing back to sunshine. Mid-70s for the beaches. Morning clouds will give way to afternoon sunshine for the inland valleys as well. Temperatures there mostly in the low 80s over the next few days. As for the mountains, clear with upper 70s right through Saturday. And then plenty of sunshine, as usual, for the deserts, triple digits above 100 degrees. You can find tonight's stories on our website, kpbs.org/evening edition. Thanks for joining us. Have a great night.